coming from Ephesians chapter 4, verses 2 through 6. And I'm going to be reading from the New Living Translation. So it might sound just a little bit different than those who maybe have the Septuagint or other versions. It reads as follows. Always be humble and gentle. Be patient with each other, making allowance for each other's faults because of your love. Make every effort to keep yourselves united in the Spirit, binding yourselves together with peace. For there is one body and one Spirit, just as you have been called to one glorious hope for the future. There is one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all, in all, and living through all. You may have your seats. I want to also read from the Message Bible, but you don't need to see it, just because you'll get to know me a little bit more, but I'm a linguistic. So sociocultural anthropology is kind of like being a doctor, and then being a surgeon, I'm a linguistic anthropologist. So I study language, and I study the importance of language and how language is used to prioritize identity. That was my PhD. And I worked with individuals who are both deaf and African American. I'm a sign language interpreter as well. So I'm interested in language. So in the Message, this is what the verse says in the Message Bible. It says, in the light of all this, here's what I want you to do. While I'm locked up here, a prisoner for the master, I want you to get out there and walk. Better yet, run on the road God called you to travel. I don't want any of you sitting around on your hands. I don't want anyone strolling off down some path that goes nowhere. And mark that you do this with humility and discipline, not in fits and starts, but steadily, pouring yourselves out for each other in acts of love, alert at noticing differences, and quick at mending fences. You are all called to travel on the same road and in the same direction, so stay together, both outwardly and inwardly. You have one master, one faith, one baptism, one God, and Father of all, who rules over all, works through all, and is present in all. Everything you are and think and do is permeated with oneness. Your theme, 75 years of working, praying, serving, and walking together as one body in Christ. What a powerful theme, peoples. Paul wrote this letter while he was in prison, and he simply wanted to encourage the church. He knew there would be struggles, because we're human, and there's struggles. But he also knew that there was something bigger than us and bigger than them. Verse 6 makes it very clear that we should be doing this with one God who is over us, in us, and through us. Which means, so the first caveat to all of this, it means we have to have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. There is no expectation to pray, to serve, to work, and walk together without Christ. There is no expectation. But with Christ, we can do all things. So the first thing, peoples, we have to make sure that we all have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. Verse 2 simply says, always be humble and gentle. Be patient with each other, making allowance for each other's faults because of your love. Now, did you notice that Paul is putting the onus on us? He's telling us how to treat others. He's not telling others how to treat us. He's telling us what we should be doing, how we should be treating others, how we should react to others. You have to intentionally want to be humble and gentle and patient and bear one another. It is not easy. It is something that we work towards. The idea that we're working, we're praying, it's a verb, we're action, we're always doing something. It is something we're always trying to be humble. We're always trying to be gentle. It is making progress. Pastor Malin always reminds me, always says to me, Heather, you are not responsible for how others treat you, but you are responsible for how you treat others. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. We are responsible for how we treat others. They're not responsible for how they treat us. Always be humble. Always be gentle. Always loving. Why? Because there's something bigger than all of us. And like I said, the first product is really Christ. And if Christ can always be humble toward us, if he can always love us, if he can always be gentle towards us, we should then be able to do it to others. Verse 3 says, make every effort to keep yourselves united in the Spirit, binding yourselves together with peace. We have to make the effort, y'all. Which is a result, and just so you know, effort, it means to be a result of something, a result of an attempt. It is a physical or a mental exertion. Other words for the word effort that we have to make, it means to attempt, to endeavor, to have an intention, a resolution. It means to struggle. It means an accomplishment or an aspiration. And we're doing all that to be united with the Spirit. The efforts, it says, make every effort to keep yourself united with the Spirit. So we are attempting, we're making a physical or a mental exertion to be united with the Spirit. We are making an accomplishment. We are endeavoring to work with the Spirit. Why? Because if we do that with the Spirit, then we know we can do it with others. If we are united with the Spirit, then peace will come among others. But first, we have to be united with the Spirit. Isn't that awesome? So it's really not about you. It's really about my relationship with him. And if I have a relationship with him, then all of this is going to work itself out. That's just awesome to remember. That's just something to keep in mind. So we are doing all that to be united with the Spirit, because we know if we do, then we can live in peace with our brothers and our sisters. And the thing I appreciate about Paul was that he was honest and he was clear to inform us that, yes, you will have struggles. There will be times when there is no peace, and that it would be difficult to maintain that peace that we want to have on this journey. And I'm sure, peoples, after 75 years, I'm sure there's been some difficult times. I'm sure there's been some times when you felt like there was no peace to be found. But just know, if you are united with the Spirit, then all this right here can work itself out. And that's all he's asking us to do, is to have a personal relationship with him, and then he will make everything else work out. Verse 4 says, for there is one body and one Spirit, just as you have been called to one glorious hope for the future. Now in this context, the one body refers to the universal church, so not people, but the universal church of the body of believers. However, for this conversation today, at your church anniversary and in your theme, I want us to think about the people's congregation being in one body, one Spirit. The one Spirit refers to the Holy Spirit that lives in all of us once we give our life to him. He lives in each and every one of us. So if we are to be one church, peoples, and we are to have one vision for the glorious hope for the future of this church, peoples, that vision of the church, it comes from the Holy Spirit, but it comes to our pastor. So if we say that we trust and believe God and that he knows what we need, and that according to Jeremiah 3:15, I will give you pastors according to my heart, which shall feed you with knowledge and understanding. Then why don't we trust the vision of our pastor? It's his responsibility to have the vision for the church. That's the word. Jeremiah 3:15, I will give you pastors according to my heart. What that means is I will give you pastors who are following me, my Spirit. That's what that means in that part. So if we say we trust the word and that we believe in Christ, then why don't we believe the vision that God is giving the pastor? There's one pastor. There's one vision. There's one body. That's what the word. That's what the word. So if we are to be in unity, then we need to follow the vision that God has given the pastor. Now, we're all people and we're human. So if that vision doesn't line up with what you think it should be, the prayer then should be, God, please allow my pastor to truly hear from you, to truly understand the vision that you're giving us. And then, Holy Spirit, please allow me to accept the vision that you have for this house. And that should be the prayer. As opposed to causing discord, or not understanding the vision and wanting your own vision and creating churches within churches and putting other pastors in front of your pastor. The one thing that's the truth. Have mercy on that. So I'm a pastor's assistant. I'm pastor Manoway's assistant. And so people think that I have a lot of offices and I serve a lot. Oh no, I'm just his assistant. But because Pastor Manoway is the pastor that he is, I'm in a lot of different places and doing a lot of different things. But the truth is, I really only hold one office, and that's like I'm a minister at my church. But I'm his assistant, and so I do a lot of different things, and people see me in a lot of different places. So I guess I want to say all that to say that I believe in my pastor and the vision that God has given him. So I'm one of those people, I'm one of those servants who believes the pastor. And the prayer is, God, please continue to speak to my pastor. Continue to give him a clear vision for the church. And then allow me to accept the vision that you've given the church, as opposed to trying to create parachurches within the church. That's your theme, and that's your scripture. You said one body in Christ. Verse 5 says, there is one Lord, one faith, and one baptism. So like I said, remember, we have to be in Christ for you to even attempt any of this stuff. We have to have a relationship with Christ. So the one Lord being referred to in here is the Lord of Lords and the King of Kings, yes. Jesus Christ. So we have to believe in him and him alone. One faith is referring to the truth of God's word, the inerrant word of God, the Bible. Everything that we need comes from the Bible. There's literally nothing new under the sun. So when there's a problem or a situation, we go to the Bible. That is the one faith that we should be having as we're walking and praying and serving together. One faith, the word of God. And then one baptism. Now, baptism is that, in the physical sense, baptism is the water submersion of a person. But in the spiritual sense, it means that we recognize that we accepted Jesus Christ, and we recognize that we need to die to ourselves, to our old selves. And so we take that, we make that public profession. So I'm going to go down my old self, and then I'm going to come up a new person in Christ. Water baptism is simply an outward expression of an inward change. It's not salvation. It's telling you to hold me accountable because I said I was saved and that I gave my life to Christ. And now I'm asking you to please hold me accountable for what I'm saying, how I want to walk, how I want to serve, and how I want to pray in one body, as one body in Christ. So me going down in the water is saying that my old self is gone, my new self is here in Christ, and that now I live for him according to his way and no longer my own. Verse 6 says, one God and Father of all, who is over all, in all, and living through all. Now, interesting in this scripture, in this verse here, is that Paul emphasizes both God's personality, meaning the Father of all, our Father, and then his transcendence and his omnipresence, who is above all and through all and in you all. So if we believe in the oneness of God and that he is in us and he's working through us, then how can we not be serving together, unified? How can we not be working together, unified? How can we not be praying together, unified? That would mean that one of us is not telling the truth. And the word says in Numbers, chapter 23, verses 19, and this is the New Living Translation. It says, God is not a man, so he does not lie. He is not human, so he does not change his mind. Has he ever spoken and then failed to act? Has he ever promised and not carried it through? Right. That's the word. So what does it mean? So these are the verses. So let's talk about this. What does it mean to work together, people? So when I'm thinking of working together, I was thinking of teamwork. So being on a team, not being alone. All of us need someone. We're not islands unto ourselves. Now you may want to feel like you don't want nobody or need nobody, but that's not the truth. All of us need somebody. And I recognize that being on a team can be difficult because there are many personalities and dispositions. But remember, this is not even about us. It's about working together as one body in Christ. And the benefit of having other people on our team is that then they can help you get better because they see things about you that you can't necessarily see. In Proverbs chapter 27, verse 17, it says, iron sharpens iron, and one man sharpens another. We should want to always improve and get better and allow other people to see us and then sharpen that iron. Now remember, I'm saying this, we're all in Christ. So I'm not talking about people cutting us down and giving us advice that's not godly or not Christianly. I'm talking about people who are in Christ. We're one body in Christ. So there's a trust there that they're sharpening me for his glory and for my good. In Ecclesiastes 4:9, it says, two are better than one, because they have a good reward for their toil. For if they fall, one will lift up his fellow. But woe to him who is alone when he falls, and not another to lift him up. Another benefit of working on these team peoples is to have people encourage us. Having people like on the sidelines, you know, cheering us on when we feel like our strength is about to be gone. So you feel like you're the only one working, you're the only one praying, you're the only one serving. But you have people that are cheering you on, saying, I'm with you, I'm here. So even if they're not in the game with you, they're still encouraging us. That's what it means to be part of a team. Another benefit from working together with the team is that all of us can contribute. All of us are important, and all of our work is needed to make this effort successful. All of us are important. The kingdom needs all of us. It needs every single one of us. In Corinthians, in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 14 through 16 say, it says, for the body does not consist of one member, but of many. If the foot should say, because I am not a hand, I do not belong to the body, that would not make it any less a part of the body. And if the ear should say, because I am not an eye, I do not belong to the body, that would not make it any less a part of the body. We are all needed, every one of us. After 75 years of working together, peoples, we should be stronger. We should be wiser. We should be wiser right now. So what does it mean to pray together? We often say that prayer is communication with God. It is how we talk to him. And the truth is, he really does want to hear from us. He truly wants to hear everything we have to say. And we're confident in talking to God because we know that he can intervene and affect changes in nature and in the course of this world, of how we exist today. In Psalm 65:1-2, it says, we will fulfill our vows to you, for you answer our prayers. All of us must come to you. So us praying to God should be a two-way conversation. I'm sure all of us have someone in our life, and you feel like, all I have been doing is listening. And it was a monologue as opposed to a dialogue. But with God, it should be a dialogue, meaning we talk to him through prayer, but then he talks to us through his word. So the idea is that we have to know the word, and we have to be continually in the word. So to hear from him is to hear his word and to understand his word. He wants to have a reciprocal relationship with us. And so when we talk about praying together, it gives us a sense that we are praying for a similar outcome or a similar purpose, and that we should be doing this and we should be doing it together in this one body in Christ. We're not praying for someone to leave the ministry because they're getting on my last nerve. We're not praying for, okay, I just want this ministry, this event to be over. We're not praying for that. No, we're praying for this oneness, this one body. We're praying for God, your purpose to be fulfilled. We're praying for God, you bring people in. God, you help me change my disposition. Because I know maybe that spirit is reacting to my spirit. So change my spirit, God, so it can change that spirit. So God, help me as much as you're helping them. Yeah. That should be the prayer that we're in. That's the conversation we should be having with Christ. Because we're in Christ. This is all about us being in Christ. I'm talking to believers here. And we will have altar calls. So if we need any new converts, let me introduce you to my best friend. But I'm talking to believers here. So then, you know, we always talk about be careful what you pray for. So be careful what you pray for. The grass is not always greener on the other side. So sometimes we have to, you know, turn that mirror inward and look at myself and see, what am I doing? What am I doing in this situation to cause this right here? What am I doing? So anthropologists, we talk about how culture is always changing. And believe it or not, when someone enters into your culture, be that your home, your church, your workplace, that culture is automatically changed. So when I entered into this room, I changed the culture of peoples because my presence is here. So what kind of culture have you changed by your presence? So when you enter into a meeting, how has that culture changed? When you enter into the sanctuary, how has that culture changed? What have you done to change that culture? And then how have people welcomed you into their culture? That's what I'm always interested in. And so sometimes we need to look at, I need to look at myself. Sometimes it's me, oh Lord, it's me, oh Lord, standing in need of prayer. So what does it mean to serve together? And I do love serving. I love serving. But this right here, serving, serving is one of the most challenging principles for the believer. It is the hardest thing for us to accomplish. And you know why? Because it deals with serving other people. If I was just serving myself, I would be fine because I know exactly what I want, when I want it, how I want it, how I want it, how I want it. I have my own little appreciation party all the time. I make my own little plaque, my own little flowers. Oh, appreciate Heather today. But that's not the case. I'm not serving me. I'm serving other people. But ultimately, I'm serving Christ. He's allowing me to serve other people. So this is why it can be so difficult. Because it's not necessarily reciprocal. And as people, we want to give and we want to get. But about Christ, it's all about giving.
Yeah.
It's truly all about giving. So when we talk about serving, we go back to verse 4 where Paul tells us, we are to be humble and gentle. To be a servant is one, you have to have an attitude of humility and then an attitude of gentleness. You can't serve expecting or wanting recognition. So I'm going to tell you right now, people, after 75 years, you can't serve to get recognition. It's really about doing it for others. I was touched by what Pastor Davenport said today about your mission effort in taking the men from UGM to go to IHOP. When we talk about missions is truly to give to somebody with no expectation I'm going to get anything back. That's what missions really means. And so when he talked about taking the men, and I thought, wow. Because even at Tabernacle, we have mission efforts and we have a homeless feeding that feeds once a month. And I think, you know what? When they come, they get the same meal every month. And I never thought about the power of having a menu and having a choice. I never even thought about that until he said that to me. He didn't say it just to me. He said it to all of us and I was here. But when he said it, it landed on me personally. Like, oh my gosh, you're totally right. Like, we do all these things, yet we never even thought about what would we like to have a menu in front of us to have a choice. So I'm saying all that to say that when we serve others, it's really truly just about them and it's not about us. So if you go into this walk with Christ, serving others, waiting for a recognition, waiting for your own appreciation day, waiting for your plaque, and waiting for your flowers, you won't be waiting a long time. Another minister at church, we always say to each other, oh, your mansion looks so beautiful. It looks so beautiful on that corner road in the pearly gate. And I say, your mansion looks beautiful too. I can't wait to come over and see your mansion too. And I say, yeah, my mansion will be one of those, move that bus, like extreme home makeover. That's my mansion in heaven. And that's what I'm saying. I'm not waiting to see my mansion here on earth. I'm not served to get recognition here on earth. I really am waiting to get recognition. And I know that can be hard for us to truly hear, but truly, truly, we're serving Christ. We're serving, he's allowing us to serve his people. You're his people. You're his sons and daughters. And what, God, you allow me to serve your sons and daughters? Thank you, God, for trusting me with your sons and daughters. Jesus himself is our role model. He himself said in Matthew chapter 20, verse 26, that whoever wants to become great among you must be a servant. He went on to say, the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many. So if Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, came here to serve, then who am I to expect to be anything different? Who am I to expect to get any other recognition? If we look at Jesus' life, we know what he received. He was, remember the thorn, remember the cross, remember the beating, remember the spitting? That's what he got, my Lord and Savior. And I want something different than he got?
Yeah.
So when I'm thinking about serving and a servant's attitude, it's really to always remember that I'm serving Christ. In serving one another, it doesn't require any special talent. It just requires that you put the needs of others before your own. And that you have a servant attitude. And that you become observant. And you notice what needs to be done. Now, serving someone can be and that everyday practical thing. It doesn't have to be grandiose. It can be one of those things like, I go to Starbucks and I know my coworker doesn't have an opportunity because she might miss her bus, so I bring her a cup of coffee. Or it might be, I understand there's a mother with a child and she wants to stay for the service, but I can go stand in the foyer. It doesn't have to be grandiose. Serving others can be a simple, practical thing. The most important aspect of serving, especially in the church, is consistency and commitment. And sometimes that's what's hard for us as humans, this idea of consistency and commitment. Now, people can be consistent and committed to being on this corner for 75 years. What can we do, members of people, to be in our, for our consistency and our commitment? And I'm sure that all of us have been, you know, have become frustrated when we begin to depend on someone, and then for whatever reason, they're no longer here. So my advice for anyone who is, before you even take on, you want to serve, to count up the cost, and to be realistic about what you can do. One thing I always say at Tabernacle is, when I'm asking someone to serve, I always say to them, don't tell me what you can't do, tell me what you can do, and just do that. Trust me, you doing a little with the right attitude consistently is much more appreciative than you doing a lot inconsistently with the wrong attitude. It truly is. The sermon scripture to memorize and eternalize is Colossians 3:23-24. Whatever you do, work at it with all your heart as working for the Lord, not for human masters, since you know that you will receive an inheritance from the Lord as your reward. It is the Lord Christ you are serving. So what does it mean to walk together? So on the physical side, when I'm thinking about people walking together, I think about, you know, two people walking in the same direction. Now they might have different ideas about how to get there, but they're at least trying to get in the same destination. People don't usually just meander and walk around in circles. There's usually a purpose for our walking as opposed to just going around and around. So for 75 years, people, you've been walking together for a purpose, for a destination. The motto on your letterhead says you're a relentless gospel for all places and all times. And that is definitely a reason to walk together. In the Bible, however, when it talks about our walk, it usually refers to our lifestyle or to a lifestyle. In Colossians chapter 3, verse 7, it says, you used to walk in these ways in the life you once lived. So it's referring to an old lifestyle. But once we gave our life to Christ, we became one with him. We changed our walk. We changed our lifestyle. So peoples, have we changed our old lifestyle? Question mark. And are we walking in the same direction with Christ? Question mark. Can people see that our walk with Christ and for Christ is different? Believe it or not, people are actually watching you. They're actually watching us to see how we will react, how we settle our differences, how we continue to let our light shine in this day and age. Especially in this day and age, what a wonderful opportunity as Christians that we have an opportunity to let our walk with Christ shine. Over the past 75 years, our neighborhood has truly changed. I was born and raised on 32nd and Yesler. I now live on 23rd and I go to Tabernacle. I've been in this neighborhood for 47 years. I can say this neighborhood has truly changed. But people want to see how we will react to the change. What will we do to bring a relentless gospel to all places for all times? But it's not only the people outside who are watching us and wanting to see how we react. It's also people inside the church. They want to see how we will react and how we will deal with the change. They want to see what's going to happen if there's a change in leadership. How will we react to that change in leadership? How will we react if there are certain programs that we just always used to have and now we no longer have? How will people react if there's a war for a change in a program that we used to do and now there's a different vision? They want to see if this is going to be the straw that breaks our back and has us lead, or are we going to be in one body with Christ and be able to settle our differences? So believe me, there are people inside and outside watching you, wanting to see how you're going to continue to do this for another 75 years. As the word says in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 58, therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. For as much as you know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord, People's Institutional Righteous Church, we need you to continue working, praying, serving, and walking together as one body in Christ. Thank you, and God bless you.